In this video, I will show you how to perform a correspondence analysis using the data from our database and LibreOffice Calc and a small tool named Tosca that's online available. For a correspondence analysis, we need the graves and different artifacts in those graves. So the graves as rows and the different types of artifacts in the graves as columns. And to get this information in this way, we have to at first download the data from the database and then also use a pivot table to bring them in the right form. And then we have to clean the data later on a bit so that the necessities for correspondence analysis are fulfilled. I will show you this now. We start with our database and we need to produce a query that gives us this specific information that we need. And to do so, we don't have this query set up yet. I will just right click here and say edit database file. And I'm here in the query view. I create a query in the design view from scratch. So of course we need the information from the artifacts, but also from the types of the artifacts, because we would like to use the name of the types as information, as a category. And I will also add the graves so that we get the grave numbers and don't have to work with the grave IDs. Okay, so we need this kind of table structure here, and I start with the grave number and the name of the types. I can run this query and it looks like that. For example, in grave 8 we have a lot of spiral rolls here and so on. Okay, yet now I will save this query for later use and I will name that, let's say, types per grave, clicking OK. And also I will save the whole database that the query is also saved with it. Now we can go to the Calc program again and we can see here is our new query there. So here's the result of the query, and to bring it down to the spreadsheet part, I have to click here in the upper left corner to select everything, say copy, and then going down below here, say paste, and then we have the information here in the spreadsheet view. Now I can turn off my navigator here, the data source navigator, by removing it, clicking on view, and then deselecting data sources here. Currently, we have for each object the name of the object and the grave number there. And to transform that into a table where we have the grave number as rows and the different objects as columns, we have to start again producing a pivot table by clicking on data and pivot table, create. Current selection is fine. So grave numbers should be rows. For each grave there should be a row. And for the columns, there should be here name representing the different names of the artifacts. And also I add for the count, I add into data fields the count of the grave numbers, giving us the count of the grave numbers per burial item type. We could also use name here and then have the count of burial items per grave. Doesn't matter one way or the other. Good, now we have our table here in a format like we need it to be. But now, this next step is we have to clean the data a bit. Because for a correspondence analysis, columns like that, where only one artifact, where only in one grave the artifact type is represented, is not usable. And also, things like this, where there is only one type of artifact in the grave, is also not usable here, so we have to move them. To get this done, I first copy the content of this pivot table to a normal table by saying edit, copy, make a new sheet, and edit. Paste again, and then we have here not the pivot table automation attached, but this is now just pure numbers. Now we need to count how many cells are actually represented by a value. For example, here we should get the value 1, and here we should get the value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we can do that by using the inbuilt function count and then selecting the range in which we would like to count cells that are occupied. So 5 is the correct number. If I copy that over here, we get 1, that's also the correct number, so I can just start copying that to the whole range of data like that. So that was for the columns. We need to do the same for the individual rows. So it's again count and then going here to the total content of the data, closing the bracket, and also copying that to the whole range of data. And now we can start removing different columns. We start with these columns that only contains one artifact, and they have to be removed by selecting them and saying delete column. We do the same here for the clay disk, unfortunately, and also for these artifact types, because they don't give us additional information for the correspondence analysis. When I have done that here for the columns, you can see here there are only values represented that are beyond 2, so that's fine. But now we have to do the same for our rows. So here we have graves that contain only one artifact type, and I have to remove these rows by clicking on delete row. So first right click here and then say delete row, and the same for all the individual rows where the value is below 2. And I'm nearly finished with that. So this one is left, and then we're fine. Probably you realized that while I was doing that, also these numbers down below has changed, because some of these artifacts types were only represented in one grave. So when I remove this grave here, also this column is again changed. So I have to redo this again for the columns, look to the rows. Okay, now I have again one row that's below 2. I have also deleted that, and now the data look fine. So this is the remaining information that we can feed into the correspondence analysis. We can remove these counts here because they are just utilities and not representing real data. After removing the unnecessary rows and columns and also the utility functions down here, we are left with all the information that we need for the correspondence analysis. There's one thing left to do, and that's we have to fill these empty cells with zeros. We can do it like that. We select those range that we want to change, click on edit, find and replace, and say we replace empty cells with a zero. Now we can click replace all, making sure that current selection only is set here. And now we have everything everywhere here is zero. You might see that the zeros are aligned to the left, and also if we click to the individual cell, there's a small quotation mark here. It means it's a textual representation of the zero. There are multiple ways to remove that. None of them is really smart. We just stick with that and save it in a specific way that this doesn't matter. So we have to save that as CSV file, save as, and I call that Miskovice CSV. Select here text CSV, call it Miskovice, and I specifically want to edit the filter settings. So I click this here, and then I click on save. In my case, it was already there, so I want to replace that. And here you have the export filter settings. So with that, you define how the export should take place. Because we have this textual representation of zero, and we want to have them as strings, we remove the string delimiter. And with that, the zeros are later on counted as zeros. Okay, now I can click OK here. And I get a warning that only this active sheet was saved. That's fine for me. And now we can have a look at this file. And it's this one here. And we can see here we have the grave numbers and the different types, and here the numbers accordingly separated by a comma. That's the CSV format. It's very simple. New rows are indicated by a line break and new columns by a comma here. Okay, now we can use this file for doing the correspondence analysis and disaggregation. For that, we need to open the Tosca tool. So let me give you an empty browser window, and what we need to type is tosca.archaeological.science. It's a shortcut that will lead us to the place where the app is actually stored. And now we can upload here a CSV file. We click on Browse and select the CSV file that we used in the first place. And now we have here the different informations visible. So the columns represents different types, the rows represents the different objects, and number within represents the count of these different objects. Here are several possibilities to change the loading if the CSV file is formatted differently. So for example, if we don't have any row names given, then also the first column would be evaluated as actual column, but in this case this represents the row names, so we leave it like that. If we don't have a header, the first row represents also data, but in our case it represents the column names, so we leave header marked. And then there are different separations. We have a comma separation, but if you use a continental spreadsheet software, it might be the case that you have a semicolon separation. So you can change this here until that what you see here is looks like the data you want to have. You can also display all the data or just the first six. Most of the time the first six are enough to see if the data are loaded in a meaningful way. Okay, now we have it like that. Now we can click on Go, and there is our correspondence analysis of the data. And as I have already said in the course, this data set is not very well suited for doing correspondence analysis and seriation, but we can still see the possibilities and options here. So let's first go to seriation. And seriation is a method of ordering these objects in respect to their similarity, either with reciprocal averaging, which is an iterative and quite simple tool, or using correspondence analysis. And here you can see it forms slightly this kind of diagonal that we would like to have, which represents the seriation of the data. So more similar objects are brought together, and if there is good additional information, we could assume that time is the most ordering factor here, but we have to make sure that this comes from an external source. We can't just induce that from the data themselves. For the correspondence analysis itself, the x-axis here is used as the ordering information for the seriation. So things that are here to the far right end up in the seriation here on the top, while things that are quite left, animal bones for example, end up here on the bottom. So it orders things in relation to their position of the x-axis. Having this two-dimensional plot, we already see a bit more of structure here. For example, Daggerblade and these knotted-headed pins are separating quite well. They are only represented, or they're represented in very few burials here. And so they distinguish themselves from most of the other objects. And there are also more dimensions to that. So, as I have said in the course, The data are ordered in respect to their similarity. The similarity can take place on different dimensions. So if we can also, might be interesting to also see, for example, the third dimension, or plot the second to the third dimension to see if something of meaningful structure comes out of this display. And you can also zoom in and zoom out using these bars here. And with that, you can see how these different objects are aligned. And if you're lucky, you will find a pattern there that gives you some information about structure in the data. When there's a lot overlap, you can use this button spread labels. And then if this is necessary, these labels are placed on small lines so that they can still be readable, although they get smaller if you do that. But here there's some overlap going on, but most of the information are readable here. You can also choose if we only want to see the types or if you only want to see the sites or seeing both. And again, I will zoom out here, that we see everything. And what you would like to see, only the text, only the points, or both, like it's done. And you can download the result as SVG, PDF, and PNG, and then embed that into your presentation or publication. With that, you can work here with the data. So that was the more or less technical presentation of correspondence analysis, preparation of the data, and doing the correspondence analysis using Tosca. If you want to have more details, I've recorded other videos in German that explains more of the background of correspondence analysis. We will not go into detail here with that.